Microphone check. 1, 2. The microphone check. 1, 2. 1, 2. The microphone check. I got my headphones tuned between two different AM stations, and my briefcase is full of declassified information. Declassified. Declassified.
Good evening, and welcome to News from Neptune for the 29th week of 2016. I'm Carl Osterbrook. Since the summer of 1990, this program has been a weekly hour of spontaneous and unrehearsed discussion of the news of the week and its coverage by the media, first on a so-called community radio station, but I was no platform there. No platforming is a recent coinage in the university and media. It means depriving someone of a place to speak because of what they're saying. I appreciate the chance to come to you now via Urbana Public Television and YouTube. Our program's name, News from Neptune, comes from Noam Chomsky, who's been writing sensible things about U.S. politics for more than half a century. Chomsky says that in the U.S. media, either you repeat the same conventional doctrines everybody is saying, or else you say something true and will sound like it's from Neptune. Tonight, David Green, Ron Zook, and I will try to say some true things. It's July 22nd, in a week in which it became ever clearer that the dominant political traditions in America today are neoliberalism and neoconservatism. They're not an opposing pair, as old-fashioned liberalism and conservatism are supposed to be, or as Republican and Democrat are supposed to be. Neoliberalism means the use of government power to destroy unions, curb social supports, like Social Security and Medicare, restrain wages and the like, in order to enhance the profits of the U.S. elite, the 1%. The short name for the neoliberal program is austerity. It means the confiscation of the lifestyle of the majority of the U.S. population for the profit of the few. It's been going on for the better part of 40 years. Wages have been flat in America since 1973. Neoconservatism means the active use of military power, that means killing people, for the same purpose, to enhance the profits of the U.S. elite, the 1%. The best recent example is the greatest crime of the century so far, the U.S. invasion and destruction of what the Pentagon calls MENA, Mideast and North Africa. The short name for the neocon program is aggression, ongoing war. So, in fact, they fit together rather nicely, thank you. Aggression and austerity, neocon and neoliberal. What's remarkable about the current presidential election is that in every presidential election for 40 years, the major party candidates supported, both of them, some version of neoliberal and neocon principles. But not this year. An unlikely presidential candidate, Donald Trump, was demonstrating opposition to both neoconservative and neocon and neoliberal principles, and thereby giving the U.S. political establishment, which is thoroughly neoliberal and neocon, and therefore backs Hillary Clinton, giving that establishment a case of the vapors. Here's the problem for the establishment in two steps. One, Clinton's a neocon, and Trump isn't. The serious foreign policy issue in the presidential campaign is indeed radical Islam, jihadism, al-Qaeda and ISIS, and the differing policies of the U.S. parties towards it. Clinton and the neocons want to use jihadists for the foreign policy objectives of the 1%. First of all, controlling energy flows in the Mideast, and secondly, stymieing Russia militarily, to prevent the economic integration of Eurasia. Compare in this regard the Obama administration's harassment of China in the South China Sea, at the other side, as it were, of Eurasia. The real scandal of Benghazi, for example, was that it was a CIA channel for weapons to jihadists in Syria. Trump and the anti-neocons, on the other hand, want to eliminate terrorist attacks in the West by sympathizers of radical Islam. They think this can be done only in cooperation with Russia. But for Clinton, of course, Putin is the new Hitler. They recognize that these attacks, another one of which apparently has occurred today in Munich, and the attacks go back, of course, to 9/11, which is an attack of the same sort, are blowbacks from Western attacks in the Mideast, from the first Gulf War in 1991 through the destruction of Iraq and Libya to Obama's drone assassinations, which Noam Chomsky has called the most extreme terrorist campaign of modern times. They recognize the elementary truth in Auden's verse, "I and the public know what all school children learn. Those to whom evil is done do evil in return." The United States has been busily doing evil in the Mideast, and the blowback is killing people in the West now. The second step of the argument is to realize that Clinton's a neoliberal and Trump isn't. The serious domestic issue in the presidential campaign is indeed making America great again. But that means restoring the economic prosperity of the 80% of the population who've had their former lifestyles confiscated by the conscious, calculated policy of the U.S. business class since the 1970s. That is neoliberalism. Clinton and her Wall Street patrons want to continue this American form of austerity practiced by the Bush and Obama administrations, the reduction of social supports, now called entitlements, and the suppression of unions and existing wage structures by means of offshoring and financialization. Globalization is the term. The trade pacts that the major parties have pressed for, from NAFTA to TPP and the TTIP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership and the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, are not free trade agreements, but rather investor rights agreements, which remove corporations from legal control by the states in which they operate, including the United States. Trump and the anti-neoliberals, on the other hand, want the restoration of prosperity, as they recall it, now largely from their parents' generation, from World War II to 1973. Productivity and wages increased with equal steps. But since then, productivity has continued to increase, but incomes have been flat for most Americans, who have increasingly to support themselves with debt, one form of which, housing debt, produced the 2007-08 crisis, from which the majority have never recovered. 95% of the income gains in the Obama years have gone to the top 1%, resulting in the rapid increase of inequality at an accelerating rate. Populist sentiment, so deplored by the bien-pensant, animates the Trump campaign, as it did the Sanders campaign and the Brexit vote in the UK. Shelley described it at the beginning of the capitalist age. "Rise like lions after slumber, an unvanquishable number. Shake your chains to earth like dew, which in sleep had fallen on you. Ye are many, they are few." And that's the spirit that Donald Trump was calling on in his acceptance speech last night. And it may well make Trump president. As a result, hysterical neocons are already talking up a coup against President Trump. I'm not making that up. The Los Angeles Times, a liberal West Coast paper, yesterday carried a long article by a well-known neocon, headlined, "If Trump Wins, a Coup Isn't Impossible Here in the U.S.
Who wrote that article?
A fellow called James Kirchick.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, right. It's I'll post it to our Facebook page. It's interesting. Kirchick is not a crazy. He's a standard issue, middle of the road sort of guy, and that's the way they're talking. A better example, if a little more obscure, was the amazing article in the New York Times day before yesterday about Trump's foreign policy views. The standard issue reporters for the Times are so astonished by this departure from orthodoxy on Trump's part that they can't even get quite clear what he's saying. I think if one reads between the lines and reads some of the other things that the Trump campaign is saying about foreign policy, it makes a little more sense. The Times article is entitled, "Donald Trump Sets Conditions for Defending NATO Allies Against Attack." And it's a good example of burying the lead, because the lead is that Trump is criticizing the neocon principles, which up to this point have been inviolable. And of course, the cake is taken by people like Max Boot, one of my favorite neocons, who says, and I quote, "Trump is reading straight from talking points of anti-American dictators," close quote. That's the that counts for political discussion in this country. I must say, with this attempt to get these matters straight, I would want to point out for the record that I, in fact, am supporting and intend to vote for Jill Stein of the Green Party, who, owing to the efforts of people like our colleague Mr. Green, is in fact on the ballot here in Illinois, and her position on the issues that we'll discuss tonight are better than those of either Trump or Clinton. But you shouldn't be dissuaded from voting for her by the argument that a vote for a third-party candidate helps Trump. He is clearly better than Clinton on both war and economic policy. So, you're watching News from Neptune, a Who's Neo edition. And first into the matrix will be Ron Zook, if that's acceptable to everybody.
Oh, sure. Well, I don't have a very coherent presentation to make today, as usual. I'll just throw a few straws in the wind or record some of those that have landed nearby in the past few days and see what we can make of them. So. They're submitted for your consideration and critique, and we'll see what happens. At the convention last week, which I guess this week, which we were forced to talk about today, a number of things going on, minor things that I noticed, and reminded me of some things in the past. I don't like that mode of inference that A reminds me of B. I want people to think by inference, and presumably a supported inference from one thing to another. But I have a great deal of skepticism about inferences of the form not only A reminds me of B, but A is linked to B, or A is supported or opposed by someone who's a supporter of B, and so on. That kind of thing gets loose in every election, and I don't believe in trying to support or oppose someone based upon what some of their supposed supporters or contributors have said or done in the past. But one thing I noticed, a little footnote here, Trump's arrival in Cleveland, apparently he flew into Cleveland in his private jet airplane, and it's not just a little corporate jet, it's a huge one. And then this helicopter that he took from the airport to the a few hundred yards outside the big hall where the convention was meeting. And there was the picture of the black helicopter descending, and then Mr. Trump emerging with a few of his followers and so on. So it reminded me, unfortunately, of the classic picture of the great leader descending from the sky that was filmed in 1934 in Nuremberg.
Now, Ron, you just said you didn't want to argue by allusion. Now, you alluded to black helicopters and Hitler's arrival at the Nuremberg rally. That's elusive, if not allusive.
A couple of sentences about what that is depicted in that film.
The film opens with shots of the clouds above the city and then moves through the clouds to float above the assembling masses below, with the intention of portraying beauty and majesty of the scene. The cruciform shadow of Hitler's plane is visible as it passes over the tiny figures marching below, accompanied by an orchestral arrangement of the Horst Wessellied. Upon arriving at Nuremberg Airport, Hitler and the other Nazi leaders emerge from the plane to thunderous applause and a cheering crowd. He is then driven into Nuremberg through equally enthusiastic people to his hotel, where a night rally is later held. It's just the image of the great leader descending from the sky, and that I was calling attention to. And I find it kind of chilling, but anyway. It's irrational. It's never intended to be an argument for or against anything. I'm very interested in this use of images and metaphors and so on to kind of influence people's thinking without any explicit claims ever being made. That's usually ineffective. You can't typically, in any kind of political or religious argument, batter people down with facts and logic and get them to persuade them of anything. It has to be done indirectly, and saying that, of course, opens the door to a lot of sub-rational propaganda, but I don't see any way around that. I want to go on to some curious doctrines of the past. I remember reading a distinguished Harvard political science professor advocating during the Bush years something called energy in the executive. And he was all for that. It was the lack of energy in the executive that he was bemoaning. Unfortunately, this all seems to have changed when Obama got elected. We didn't hear anything more about the need for energy in the executive. Where this phrase comes from apparently is in the Federalist Papers. Hamilton's Federalist number 70. We've been hearing a lot of stuff about Hamilton recently in the entertainment realm, anyway. And the Federalist, of course, is often treated as kind of holy writ in many quarters when people seek to invoke its authority for some view of their own. Hamilton wrote, "There is an idea which is not without advocates, that a vigorous executive is inconsistent with the genius of a Republican government. The enlightened well-wishers to this species of government must at least hope that the supposition is destitute of foundation, since they can never admit its truth without at the same time admitting the condemnation of their own principles. Energy in the executive is a leading character of the definition of good government, is essential to the protection of the community against foreign attacks, is not less essential to the steady administration of the laws, to the protection of property against those irregular and high-handed combinations which sometimes interrupt the ordinary course of justice, to the security of liberty against the enterprises and assaults of ambition, of faction, and of anarchy." So every man, Hamilton says, the least conversant in Roman history knows how often that the Republic was obliged to take refuge in the absolute power of a single man under the formidable title of dictator, as well as the intrigues of ambitious individuals who aspired to the tyranny, and the seditions of whole classes of the community whose conduct threatened the existence of all government, as against the invasions of external enemies who then menaced the conquest and destruction of Rome. So a lot of ideas there, but the Federalist, you may remember, is often cited as sort of holy writ in these discussions. And I'm not so sure it always is. Hamilton is navigating perilously close there to an authoritarian view of government. But anyway, the point is that when this talk about the need for energy in the executive is going on, it's typically one of the guys that we like that's in the presidency. And when it quiets down, there will be someone that we don't like. And we haven't been hearing much about the need for this during the Obama administration. So maybe it will all change again if Trump is in the White House, and we'll be hearing about the need for this again, and the founding fathers will be once again quoted, which to me is never conclusive about anything. So the pious invocation of high ethical and political principles then often goes on, which are then promptly ignored and forgotten depending upon who is under discussion. So I'll drop that there. The recent view has been that, 90% of the criticism of Obama has been getting in the mass media is that his foreign and military policy is that of a softy, a weakling, a pussy, probably because he is secretly like a Muslim, as his, like his father, and he needs to show the world that he has a pair. Indeed, this is the consistent theme through a lot of what our conservative commentators say, is the need for strength and power and toughness. And it came through in Donald Trump's speech last night, and I find that stuff really scary. Talk about a movement and the need for strength and power and toughness, which is one of the constants of right-wing political talk. And I'll ask whether it's
thank you, Ron.
Scary to other people as it is to me.
Sorry, didn't mean to jump you loud. Yeah. You're watching News from Neptune. We'll go to David Green.
Well, so I'm in the middle here. Am I scared or am I not scared? I'm a little bit scared, but not so much of Donald Trump. There's a very thick sea of liberal propaganda that we're wading through right now, even when we turn on Amy Goodman in the morning covering the Republican convention, and it'll really come to a head next week. We'll tell the tale as to whether the supposedly progressive alternative media is completely caving to the Democratic Party, is completely caving to Hillary Clinton, and will soft pedal the real threat that she, her ascendancy, will pose to many people in the world, including in this country. Obviously, I don't like Donald Trump. Obviously, he's repulsive and repellent in a lot of ways. But I'm supporting the Green Party candidate, as is Carl Jill Stein, not only because I work for, not only because I'm involved in the local Green Party, but because I would be doing that anyway. I will encourage people to vote their conscience. The only thing that we can do, I think, is to not worry about what other people are saying, what they're going to do. We should do what we think is right. I would encourage if there are four parties in Champaign County. There's the Libertarian Party, the Green Party, the Democratic Party, and Republican Party. I would encourage a debate between a representative of each of these parties regarding the presidential election. It will never happen. And if you ask why, it's because neither a Democrat nor a Republican will likely want to publicly expose themselves to having to actually support their candidate in the substantive terms of what their candidate would actually do in, as president of the United States. The only restriction I would ask on that debate is that the Democrats not the the representative for the Democratic Party not be allowed to claim that they should vote, we should vote for Hillary Clinton because Donald Trump is worse. I can't believe that anyone would want to put themselves publicly in that position. But still, what would the straightforward argument be? What is the argument that Carol Ammons is going to be using to get people to vote for Hillary Clinton? What is the argument that the head of the Democratic, the Shambie County Democrats, a woman named Maryam Ar-Rahim, what argument is she going to use? Well, that's why you're not going to hear it in public. Everything will be done. The way it's usually done is marshal the troops, get out and do this, get out and do that. But don't anybody sit around a table. Don't anybody sit behind a table in a panel at the library or anywhere else and explain to the public why it is that the public should vote for one of these four candidates, assuming that the Libertarians are on the ballot in the state, which I think they are, and they're represented by a guy named Gary Johnson. So what was I going to say?
Were you saying they shouldn't be allowed to do that?
No, I'm saying
they shouldn't get away with doing that.
We should be debating these things at the local level. And in case you don't notice it, we never actually do debate politics at the local level amongst the various parties. Oh, there's never actually any debate in which people come down from their perches and agree to sit next to other people who may be saying different things and just put out a straightforward argument. It's always come to my meeting and listen to what I have to say. Yeah. And I mean, I'm not saying the Green Party doesn't do that. Obviously, we've had meetings. But we would participate. I would participate in any such event, in the unlikely event that, in the unlikely occasion that it actually happens. So let me repeat what I've said in past weeks. You want to learn about Democrats? Go read Tom Frank's book, Listen Liberal, about the professional class, about the Democratic Party, about the takeover of the Democratic Party by the meritocratic class, by the Wall Street class, by the college-educated class. And that's basically what's, in spite of the Republican successes in the last 40 years, that's basically where we're at in this country now. The national politics are dominated by the Democratic Party and by this professional class. What's the other side of the story over the last 40 to 50 years? Well, I think it's accounted for extremely well in a intellectual historical book, but very readable book by Stephen Fraser called The Limousine Liberal, How an Incendiary Image United the Right and Fractured America. And what Fraser does, as I've said before in this program, is use the image of the sort of the populist imagery of the limousine liberal, which originated in New York in 1969, after 4 years of the mayoralty of the consummate limousine liberal, John Lindsay. He traces this image as it back and forwards from that point in time, I think relatively convincingly so. And he traces it back to Henry Ford in the 1920s, and Ford, in essence, to Donald Trump. This is right-wing populism. This is populism that incorporated the new right, the religious right. I think importantly, Fraser defines this form of populism in terms of what he calls family capitalism. We have two wings of the capitalist class in this country. We have the Wall Street capitalists, the financial capitalists, which are in the ascendant, and then we have the older style capitalists from Henry Ford on forward to the Koch brothers, and he plays this out in terms of their ability to marshal their ideology, their particular brand of the capitalist ideology, their particular brand of what came to be neoliberal and neoconservative ideology. And as it moves forward, you know, they find figureheads with which to put forward these things. Obviously, Ronald Reagan, and then George W. Bush. Well, what's happened since 2008? They've run out of people like Reagan and Bush. There were the next Bush that didn't work out. There's no more Reagans. Nobody they could sell as a Ronald Reagan, and along comes Donald Trump. He's a capitalist for sure. He's operated in a neoliberal environment for sure. You look at the ascendancy of the FIRE class, financial, insurance, real estate. Well, it's mainly the financial that we're talking about with the Democratic Party, with Wall Street, with the hedge fund managers, and so forth. And, okay, so you got the FI and you've got the the RE, the real estate. You've got Donald Trump, who made his money a little differently and has certainly profited from this neoliberal, these neoliberal decades, but has slightly different ideas, which is why he cannot find favor. I mean, his personality is one thing. His outsiderness is one thing. But he also says things, as Carl, I think, has rightly pointed out, that do not find favor with the true neoliberal neocon class, mainly trade agreements, neolib, and war, neocon, and supporting NATO and this sort of thing. He says things that, if taken out of context, could be said by people on the left. Doesn't support nation building. So we're left with this conundrum, if that's what you want to call it, as to, and I'm on my guard, I'm feeling vigilant, I'm feeling sort of anticipatorily angry with people who call themselves progressive. I think I'm going to have to sit myself down in the next few days and decide how I'm going to comport myself, since I'm the presumptive leader of the local Prairie Green Party. Haven't been elected yet, but that meeting's going to happen tomorrow at 1:30. Tomorrow, Saturday, July 23rd, mm-hmm. at 1:30 at the Esquire in downtown Champaign. If you want to show up and elect me leader of the Prairie Green chair of the Prairie Green Party, I think what I'm just going to be saying is what I started off this comments by saying, is that I'm going to put forward the argument that we should vote for Jill Stein. And I'm going to put forward the argument that Hillary Clinton is not the lesser evil of Donald Trump. I think I would probably split a few hairs with you, Carl. I think that in terms of what Trump would actually do, it's hard to imagine him acting very far outside the neoliberal, neocon fold. But at least some of the things he says are outside that. He just doesn't have any developed philosophical views as to how that would actually happen. And he's not appealing to a population that would, quote unquote, make that happen in terms of how he's going about his campaign. He did say, I guess in his speech last night, he's going to try to attract Bernie Sanders voters. But, you know, look at the contrast between the way he's been able to succeed within the Republican context, and Bernie Sanders, an allegedly the more progressive party, was unable to succeed and more seriously just flattened by the institutional forces of the Democratic Party and how that system works and how the media works and you have to throw in the fact that Trump, of course, benefited from the media coverage, from the free media coverage that he received from our mainstream media, which is now so appalled. Even the mainstream media is now appalled by his success and the things he says and does. But I think we got to focus on we got to focus on putting forth the argument that it's high time for people to vote for who they actually want. They have an opportunity to do that. They have an opportunity to look around. If people do that, then they'll look around and see there's a lot of people like them. And then we can go from there and develop a third-party movement in this country. I think now's the time. I think Jill Stein is a fine example of someone who puts forward 99% of the ideas that I would support. And I'll rein myself in at that point.
Thank you, David. We appreciate it. You were watching news from...
You mean what I said or the reining in?
maybe a little of both. Eh? No. Free rein, I think, is what we have in mind here, on at least within limits or with a certain balance.
Yeah.
We have to hook up this troika to Urbana Public Television and see if we can get all three of the horses, or most of the horses, to work together. That's our job.
Wow.
You're right.
That's a cool metaphor.
Yeah. It's been used, I think.
But in troika, that's a little suspect.
Yeah.
Well,
are you stuck in the Cold War?
It probably shows, yes, it probably shows an undue love for the president of Russia.
Yeah.
The issue which emerged from Trump's speech last night seemed to me to be quite remarkably the theme of class politics versus identity politics that we've talked about a lot here on News from Neptune. I actually didn't expect it to emerge quite that clearly. The identity politics position of the Clinton campaign was devastatingly described by Glenn Ford a while ago, where he said that the Clinton campaign will do its best to make the issue of the presidential campaign to be Trump's bigotry. That way, said Glenn Ford, her bankers are protected. That seems to me to be exactly right, and I recommend Glenn Ford's discussion of this on this point. What emerged last night was that Trump was willing to embrace the class politics that are the opposition, the fundamentally opposed position to the identity politics of the Clinton campaign. Identity politics has an interesting history. We've talked about it here on the program a number of times, and we'll undoubtedly talk about it again. But basically, identity politics is a scam, as some people, such as Adolf Reed and Walter Ben Michaels and others, have pointed out. Identity politics appeared as sort of a fallback position of American liberals in the 1970s when they gave up the class politics of the New Deal tradition under the attack of neoliberalism. So it's bound up directly with the themes that we started off tonight's program with. But it seems to me that it's remarkable that it's emerged so clearly that the Trump campaign, whatever you think of Trump himself, the Trump campaign is speaking for a class politics that is opposed to the identity politics of Hillary Clinton. Now, this is important, and it's not a matter to get confused with one's, as it were, personal distaste, as it might be, for Donald Trump. The best remark I've seen on this came from William Blum. Blum has written brilliant things about American imperialism and the American wars over the last two generations. And in a consideration of the fact that Trump was the, as he puts it, relative peace candidate, relative to Hillary Clinton, who is the war candidate, Blum says, yes, Trump's personally obnoxious. I'd have a very hard time being his friend. Who cares? His point being that the politics that are being represented here are what's important. Another friend to this ground, Jeffrey Sinclair, wrote last night, I'm quoting here, I've been watching MSDNC, that's a joke, MSDNC, I have trouble getting it right. The
MSNBC,
yeah.
Which is, he means MSNBC.
Well, he means NBC, but he's perfectly changing it
Democratic
to the DNC, that it's,
a
mouthpiece for the Democrats.
Yeah.
I've been watching MSDNC tonight, and none of their commentators, with the partial exception of Chris Matthews, seem to be able to read the class politics working in Trump's speech. This is an ominous sign for the network of a party, he means the Democrats, which is supposed to represent working class people. It has instead become the vessel for a strange collage of NGOs and identity-devoted sectors that in reality, of course, rarely intersect. Another buzzword from the current description. Obama was gifted enough to hold this fragile coalition. Hillary Clinton will have to bribe them with Wall Street money. The liberals have effectively ceded class-oriented politics to the national front right. Now, we can argue about how effective it is to describe Trump that way, but it certainly is true that the class politics have been ceded to the Trump campaign. This is Sinclair again. Trump talked explicitly about the working class, bricklayers, truck drivers, electricians, steel workers. It's been a hallmark of Clinton speak since 1992 that they only talk about the middle class, a nebulous zone of educated suburbanites with aspirations towards upward mobility. Trump completely ignored the traditional cultural issues that have freighted the GOP for 30 years and went right for the working class anxieties that the Democrats have failed to quell since the advent of neoliberalism. I can see why the Democrats are running a little scared. I think Jeffrey's right about that. And I think it, as I say, I'm surprised that it's emerged so clearly that we have Trumpian class politics opposed to Clintonian identity politics.
Well, that seems to me a bit of an exaggeration. What impresses me is that you never know what you're going to get if you...
What is this? What's the movie?
If you,
Tom Hanks?
Don't, if you vote for or support any of those people. That's why I have my little collection of dice here, a dozen of them. Every election, seems to me, is a crapshoot, in particular concerning Donald Trump. I think he is so personally unstable that you would be a little foolish in putting any weight on any particular thing that he says. He may very well say the opposite tomorrow or next week, and I can't take it all that seriously. But this raises for me a interesting ethical question I've never seen a good treatment of anywhere, the extent to which we are personally responsible for voting for someone who does bad things thereafter if they get elected to office. That's been such a rare thing for me to vote for anyone who actually wins any election and takes office. It's not been a big issue, but sometimes I do worry about it. To what extent am I complicit in voting for or even taking part in a electoral system that elects someone who does horrible things thereafter? And if you have any good insights about that, let me know. To what extent do we all become besmirched with evil when we do that?
Well, this is why presidential electoral politics at the two major party level is a lose-lose affair. It has been since that book over there, Federalist Papers, was written. And in fact, I've been wanting to talk about Alexander Hamilton in some historical terms. I was going to do it today, but given what's going on, I decided to put that off. But there's a lot of misunderstanding about that. But it would be instructive to look back at what Hamilton really stood for and the origins of the two-party system to begin to understand what we've been stuck with ever since, which is the way the ruling class governs us at the national level to the benefit of the ruling class. So we have to begin to break out of that. I'm not, Donald Trump made his fortune within the neoliberal context, within the real estate aspect of that. When he says things that he's going to cut the federal deficit, that just tells you that he doesn't understand what it's really going to take to put people to work in this country. We need for the federal government to spend money, even to go into debt He said he's going to lower taxes and he's going to cut the federal debt. He's going to cut, if he really is able to do those things, there's going to be a terrible recession in this country. I'm not saying he even knows what he's saying. He clearly hasn't thought that part of it through. And one can similarly talk about his wanting to go into the Middle East and deal with ISIS with boots on the ground in terms of his foreign policy, that in the context of not wanting to really get mixed up with nation building and so forth. So he's all over the place, obviously. I think we have a pretty low bar, the Green Party, a pretty low bar here to argue that Jill Stein is the best candidate. The Democrats are going to want to prove that Hillary Clinton is the lesser evil when you have to take pains to, like what I just did, to present Donald Trump as just as evil or no less evil than Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton might she might throw a few more crumbs at various groups, but there is a certain identity politics involved. There has been, I think, what this book is arguing, in terms of the sort of intersection of class and identity politics on the right. But the ascendancy of Trump has meant that identity politics on the right isn't what it used to be when the religious right can kind of be folded into the neoliberal neocon right under a figure like Ronald Reagan or George W. Bush. Trump has busted up that game. And so they're wondering what to do, and that's why, as Carl, as you say, these people like, I mean, you've got Daniel Pipes, okay, the ultimate Islamophobe, the ultimate Zionist Islamophobe, saying that he can't support Trump, that he's going to support Hillary Clinton. Well, why? Because Hillary Clinton says absolutely horrible things about Israel and Palestine. I could never vote for anybody who says that Israel is somehow victimized by the Palestinian people. That's a horrible, hideous statement. Are you going to be hearing about that in the coming weeks? Maybe from Cornel West, you will be, who was on the Democratic Platform Committee and says he's going to vote for Jill Stein. So we live in interesting times.
And well, you are watching news from Neptune in interesting times. We have a few minutes left. Go ahead, Ron.
Well, again, I will emphasize that the problem for me is being a citizen and voting and doing all these things that citizens are supposed to do is always a crapshoot. And to what extent does it embroil you in horrible crimes against people, against humanity, and so on? If you turn out to have supported someone who is doing very bad things. And I worry about that a lot. Again, there should be a good analysis somewhere. Suppose you are candidate A, you vote for them, and you're among the majority that votes for them, and so they take office. That's one kind of situation. The other one is that you vote for them and you're in the minority and they don't take office. But to what extent?
Well, our responsibilities don't end with our voting.
Right, right. I agree.
We have a government. The governors govern on a daily, weekly, monthly basis. We need to be keeping an eye on what these people do. And it's very hard in any era, including the neoliberal era. You go back to the populist era in the late 1800s, you see what these people did without automobiles, without modern communication. You see what they did in organizing the populist party to struggle with the banks and so forth, and to develop in some areas of the country a biracial party. You see that. That's the work. We just have to keep doing this work. We have all these tools available now to do this work with,
yeah.
and we've been able to organize alternative parties, but it doesn't stop at election day. We have a federal government that's, much of what it does is unaccountable, especially in relation to foreign policy, to what anyone thinks. But we also increasingly have, that's what neoliberalism is. We have a government that's unaccountable to what anyone thinks, because it's all done behind the scenes. It's all done. It's privatized. It's austeritized. Yeah. It's whatever you want to call it, these decisions. If there's one thing people need to understand, it's how the Federal Reserve works. Who decides how money gets spent, whether it's created for public purposes or private purposes. Trump doesn't seem to understand any of that stuff, so I can't get maybe quite as excited about what he's doing as Carl is, because it's just so flawed, it's so tattered. But still, there is this class message. There is a couple of basic class-oriented mm-hmm. messages.
Well, I didn't say that citizens' responsibility stops there. And indeed, one of my themes for some time now has been, why don't we have a satisfactory theory of citizens' duties of citizenship responsibility in a nominally democratic polity, which is in fact very otherwise.
Well, capitalism makes that really difficult, because capitalists think that they should be running the country apart from any democratic process.
Right.
That's been the assumption the whole time. Yeah. So we're not a democratic country. So the point is, how do we even get to the point where we begin talking about what a democratic country might look like at any level, in terms of how the economy works, in terms of how money works?
These are not, by the way, unembedded questions, and to consider them in the abstract ignores the fact made by the late Fred Bramfen in a column that I will also post to the Facebook page for News from Neptune, that the executive branch of the U.S. government has killed, wounded, and made homeless well over 20 million human beings in the last 50 years. Leads Bramfen to suggest that the proper description of the U.S. executive branch, all presidents up to and including the present one, comprise the world's most evil and lawless institution. That is the state of the modern world. As Noam Chomsky points out, that if all post-World War II American presidents, up to and including Barack Obama, were judged by the standards of the Nuremberg Tribunal for the Nazi leaders, they'd all be hanged. They'd be executed because they are guilty of what the Nazi leaders were executed for. Now, in this situation, the question of our responsibility for the crimes of our state becomes a good deal less abstract, even-handed. We have to talk about the real historical circumstances in which these matters are discussed. When we have some time, perhaps next week, I'd like to take up the question that Ron raised tonight with the Federalist Papers about the state of the American Revolution, which exists as this mythology for our politics, and in fact is considered more and more today by people who look at the actual history to have been a defense of slavery. That's what it was really about. And the American Constitution, which is seen as this great political document to be admired by the ages, was in fact a defense of, as James Madison said, the minority of the opulent, that is the rich, against the majority. It was not democracy at all, but rather an attempt to stymie democracy, which has been remarkably successful down to the present day.
Yeah, there's a century-old argument there about the economic origins of the Constitution, going back to Charles Beard.
Exactly.
And I find a good deal of it rather convincing, but it's been endlessly attacked by other historians who are trying to refute Beard.
Organic intellectuals for the American ruling class, yes.
Since his book appeared, I think it was about 1912. But
the historian who's been most sort of corrective in relation to the wild popularity of the musical Hamilton, there's a historian named William Hoagland, Hoegeland, who's been long time writing about Hamilton in a much more critical sense, and there's a lot to say about that, including about, he argues that Hamilton wasn't opposed to slavery, even though he's apparently portrayed in this musical and in other historical understandings of as being an opponent, as a supporter of freeing the slaves. So that's one of many issues that that we could be talking about, although I fear that next week after the Democratic convention, we're still going to be stuck about where we are right now. We might as well just run the same program next week and plug in Hillary Clinton every time we say Donald Trump, and then
I think that won't work. And in fact, I think maybe next week's program,
right about that.
next week's program may be a reason, maybe a discussion of why or whether that does indeed work. That may be the point. I would like to finish up tonight with a comment from Pepe Escobar, a Brazilian-American writer on politics, who is continues to write provocative things in a late hippie style that I think sometimes detracts from the seriousness of what he does. He's one of the few people that I've seen who has actually talked about Donald Trump as a presidential candidate and the business community. Now, I said that it seemed to me that what was happening was that Trump is representing a class politics over against Hillary Clinton's identity politics. But those class politics are, in fact, not to the taste of the American ruling class, the American business class, and that is really quite remarkable. Escobar suggests something about what the politics actually look like, and I will see if I can quote him. He finds businessmen, business people, supporting Donald Trump, and he asks why. We need a fresh look at these problems that Trump brings to the table. Our problems, the business people, our problems with Mitt Romney was that he made his money taking advantage of the tax treatment for takeovers and currency rigging that shifted so much of our industry abroad. If anything, favorable tax treatment should encourage the building of productive investment as we repatriate our industries lost to currency rigging and not the creation of debt, to finance speculative takeovers or speculation in general. Speculative profits should face the highest form of taxation. This is direct criticism of neoliberalism. And Escobar says this is coming, in fact, from some American business people. The business crowd is distinctly anti-war, says Escobar. When Mr. Trump talks about war having to have rational profit and loss expectation, he is sounding as a logical businessman, they say. They also stress that the war against Russia is also destroying our oil industry, as the U.S. ordered the Gulf states to dump their shut-in oil production capacity on the oil market to bankrupt Russia and Venezuela. So here's how the playing field is shaping up, says Escobar. The neocon, neoliberal Wall Street candidate, Hillary Clinton, featuring Clinton, Flournoy at the State Department, at the Defense Department, and Newland at the State Department, itching for a war against the wall-to-wall multibillionaires, Trump, Charles and David Koch, and Adelson. These are people lining up behind Trump as a critique of the war policy and the economic policy of the Clinton campaign. So in fact, it may get a good deal more interesting, and we'll have a chance to talk about that some next week.
Can I throw in a couple of comments at the end here? One, I would highly recommend Paul Street's article on today's Counterpunch website.
To get him out of the elevator?
Political correctness, and because I think it reflects some of the things I'd like people to begin to understand. And the other thing is that I mentioned the Green Party meeting. If you're watching this on Friday evening, then the Green Party meeting's tomorrow, Saturday, at 1:30 at the Esquire. And also, I'm going to be appearing representing the Green Party on David Johnson's World Labor Hour, 11. I'm not going to be on until the noon hour tomorrow on WEFT, on the aforementioned WEFT. But his program is from 11 until about 1. And at the noon hour, I will be conversing with the World Labor Hour people about the Green Party, and I assume some of the issues that have been raised by the Republican convention this week and by Jill Stein and Hillary Clinton and the whole gang.
You've been watching News from Neptune for the 29th week of 2016, a Who's Neo edition. I'm Carl Estabrook. My discussants tonight have been David Green and Ron Zook. Our thanks to our directors and producers, Jason Liggett and Yosef Cash. Inshallah, we'll be back next week with a new edition of News from Neptune to remind you, in the words of Edward Devere, what's past is prologue, what to come in yours and my discharge. In the meantime, confusion to our enemies, and a good night to you.